Have you ever noticed that when you read a book, watch a movie, or a piece of art, sculpture, or painting, or something, how oftentimes you can see your reflection in the work, and in some way it speaks to who you are, what you've been through, what you've endured, how your life has gone? In some way, it seems that art resembles life. This painting hangs in our hallway upstairs. And when I first saw it, we were in a little gift shop bookstore in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. And literally, when I saw it, I stopped dead in my tracks and I just stared at it. And the reason I stared at it is because it resonated with me on a very deep level, because that is a picture of what my dad used to do for me. He would pray for me, he would pray with me, he would pray over me. And so that picture resembles life. It's a mirror for me as to what childhood was like for me. And so I bought it, and it's hanging in our hallway. And a couple weeks ago, I showed you kind of one that matches it, where the mother is praying, right? The angels are in the back. Well, today, as we look at chapter 17 of the story, we are going to be able to see ourselves in the plight of the people of Judah. You see, the way they acted toward God, it shocks us, it astonishes us. Clap our hands and we say, or throw our hands up in the air and say, my goodness, those people, how could they not have seen this? Or why did they continue to do that? And yet, if we really look at what we're reading, in many ways, it is a mirror. And the reflection is ourselves. Turn with me as we begin today to 2 Kings, because we see that Judah is given the same consequence, outcome, as that of Israel that we saw a couple of weeks ago. Chapter 21 of 2 Kings. We're going to read verses 1 through 15. Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 55 years. His mother's name was Hephzibah. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, following the detestable practices of the nations the Lord had driven out before the Israelites. He rebuilt the high places his father Hezekiah had destroyed. He also erected altars to Baal and made Asherah pole, as Ahab, king of Israel, had done. He bowed down to all the starry hosts and worshipped them. He built altars in the temple of the Lord, of which the Lord had said, in Jerusalem, I'll put my name. In both courts of the temple of the Lord, he built altars to all the starry hosts. He sacrificed his own son in the fire, practiced sorcery and divination, and consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the eyes of the Lord, provoking him to anger. He took the carved Asherah pole he had made and put it in the temple, of which the Lord had said to David and to his son Solomon, in this temple and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel, I will put my name forever. I will not again make the feet of the Israelites wander from the land I gave their forefathers, if only they will be careful to do everything I commanded them and will keep the whole law that my servant Moses gave them. But the people did not listen. Manasseh led them astray, so that they did more evil than the nations the Lord had destroyed before the Israelites. And the Lord said through his servants the prophets, Manasseh, king of Judah, has committed these detestable sins. He's done more evil than the Amorites who preceded him and has led Judah into sin with his idols. Therefore, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I'm going to bring such disaster on Jerusalem and Judah that the ears of everyone who hears of it will tingle. I'll stretch out over Jerusalem the measuring line used against Samaria and the plumb line used against the house of Ahab. I'll wipe out Jerusalem as one wipes a dish, wiping it and turning it upside down. I will forsake the remnant of my inheritance and hand them over to their enemies. They'll be looted and plundered by all their foes, because they have done evil in my eyes and have provoked me to anger from the day their forefathers came out of Egypt until this day. will remember that when Israel was taken into exile, when they were taken captive by the Assyrians, the scripture says that Judah was the only one left. And there was a prophet, Isaiah, that we were introduced to, who was prophesying to Israel about getting them to change their ways and to come back to the Lord. Well, today we find history repeating itself. Today we talk about Judah rather than Israel, and we are introduced to two other prophets. We here in 2 Kings chapter 21 are introduced to the king of Judah, whose name is Manasseh. We are told that his father was Hezekiah. We know that Hezekiah was a good king, right? He did good in God's eyes. However, his wife gave birth to Manasseh, who did not follow in his footsteps, and who was an evil king. It says he did more evil than all the foreign people that they were to destroy, all the kings that had come before him, all the high places, all the altars for worship of foreign gods that Hezekiah had torn down, Manasseh has rebuilt. He has reinstituted the worship of foreign gods. With this, we find him sacrificing his own son to a foreign and false god. We find him practicing divination and meeting with spiritists and mediums and all of these things that are abominable in God's eye. And because of all of his evil, because of this sin that was so rampant in his life and therefore was rampant in the life of the people of Judah, God's anger burns against Manasseh and all of Judah. And he says that because of their evil, the same plight that came to Israel will come to Judah. They will be defeated, and they will be taken into exile. Now, if you were to read this from the Chronicles, you'll see that at one point, Manasseh had this kind of revival, if you will. This renewal of his spirit, in which he hears the Lord and, in a sense, turns to the Lord. However, it is not enough. Because what happens is, other kings also followed Manasseh. And of those kings that followed Manasseh, only one of them did what God considered good in his eyes. All the others were evil. That good king was Josiah, and he became king at the age of 8. A child shall lead them, perhaps. Josiah was a good king who tore down the high places, tore down the altars of foreign gods, the Asherah poles. He is one who was king when they found a copy of the law of Moses and they began to read it. And he's like, oh my goodness, I cannot believe that we have not been doing these things. And so he begins to reinstitute the practices of godly worship. He institutes the celebration of the Passover once again. And Josiah reigns for 30 or 31 years, and all that time, Judah follows in the ways of God. But when Josiah dies, so does their faith. And once again, they turn to evil practices, because evil kings are raised up, and people once again rebel against God. And so what happens then? We go to 2 Kings chapter 24, and we find that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, invades Judah. He ultimately conquers Jerusalem, and he takes the people of Judah into captivity into Babylon. And we will learn more about their situation and about specific people and specific events that happened next week when we talk about the book of Daniel. Because Daniel is set in Babylon, where Nebuchadnezzar rules over those who are exiles from Judah. So the book of 2 Kings then ends with Jerusalem falling, Judah being overthrown by Nebuchadnezzar, and the people going into exile. And it closes with this verse. Judah went into captivity away from her land. Now, know that as the events of these kings of Manasseh and Josiah and Jehoiakim take place, as Judah and is going from evil to good back to evil, and all this is about 100 years after Israel has gone into exile, there were prophets among the people of Judah, chosen by God, used by God to share His message with His people, trying to get them to turn from their evil ways and come back to Him and follow Him once again. One of those prophets is Jeremiah. Turn with me to the book of Jeremiah. And we're going to read chapter 1, verses 1 through 10. Jeremiah is after Isaiah. Jeremiah 1, 1 through 10 describe for us Jeremiah's call to be God's messenger, to be a prophet to the people. The words of Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, one of the priests of Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin. The word of the Lord came to him in the 13th year of the reign of Judah, son of Amon, king of Judah, and through the reign of Jehoiakim, son of Josiah, king of Judah, down to the 5th month of the 11th year of Zedekiah, son of Josiah, king of Judah, when the people of Jerusalem went into exile. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations. Ah, sovereign Lord, I said, I do not know how to speak. I am only a child. But the Lord said to me, Do not say I am only a child. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Then the Lord reached out His hand and touched my mouth and said to me, Now I have put my words in your mouth. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. Jeremiah was a PK. Although instead of a pastor's kid, it would have been a priest's kid. Okay? His dad was Hilkiah, one of the priests. And his ministry starts during the reign of Josiah. Alright, so good king. So it should have been somewhat easy during that time. And it lasts until Judah goes into exile under Nebuchadnezzar in Babylon, a span of about 42 years. Now, while his ministry may have begun under Josiah, a good king, his ministry was not an easy one. It was quite difficult. Jeremiah endured much ridicule from the people. He preached repentance and the need for the people to turn back to God, but not once in his 42 years did he get any signs of encouragement. Never did he sense that there was any change taking place in the hearts of his people. Now, can you imagine doing your job, whatever it might be, and never once seeing any positives or any good come from it? Would that not be difficult? Would that not be a hard life? Would it not be hard to get up in the morning and without thinking, what is the point? And yet what we see is that Jeremiah was faithful and he persevered in his role as God's messenger. And in these verses we are told of his call to be a prophet of God. God shares with him three things. The first thing he says is, God says, Jeremiah, I've always known you. He says, Jeremiah, before you were conceived, before you began to take shape in your mother's womb, I knew you. Before your mom and dad even thought about having you, I knew you. Why is it wrong to abort a child? Because God knows that child. The second thing that he says is that, Jeremiah, you have been set apart. Jeremiah, you're special. I have a special purpose for you. I have uniquely gifted you. I have given you talents that only you have, because there's something special that I want you and only you to do. And the third thing he tells him is what that is. I want you to be my messenger, Jeremiah. I want you to be my voice to my people. I want them to know that I still love them, Jeremiah, and I'm going to speak to them through you. Let's look at what one of those prophecies was, what those words may have been. Flip over to Jeremiah 13. Or go like this a lot. Jeremiah 13, 1 through 11. This is what the Lord said to me. Go and buy a linen belt and put it around your waist, but do not let it touch water. So I bought a belt, as the Lord directed, and put it around my waist. And then the word of the Lord came to me a second time. Take the belt you bought and are wearing around your waist and go down to Pereth and hide it there in a crevice in the rocks. So I went and hid it at Pereth as the Lord told me. Many days later, the Lord said to me, go now to Pereth and get the belt I told you to hide there. So I went to Pereth and dug up the belt, took it from the place where I had hidden it, but now it was ruined and completely useless. Then the word of the Lord came to me. This is what the Lord says. In the same way, I will ruin the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem. These wicked people who refuse to listen to my words, who follow the stubbornness of their hearts and go after other gods to serve and worship them, will be like this belt, completely useless. For as a belt is bound around a man's waist, so I bound the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah to me, declares the Lord, to be my people for my renown and praise and honor, but they have not listened. Jeremiah's prophecy spoke of the disaster that was to come upon Judah if they did not repent and turn back to the Lord. And so as one example God uses to share with the people is this linen belt that he wants Jeremiah to purchase. And so Jeremiah goes, he purchases it, he uses it to hold and gather in his robes. God comes and speaks to him again and says, okay, now take that belt and go bury it. Now, many believe that where he buried it was somewhere near a river. And so he buried it in mud and in rocks and yuck and got all the water and all this stuff. And it just says after many days, we don't know exactly how long, but after enough days for this belt to be affected by the elements, he goes and he gets it and he pulls it out and he's like, this is gross, because now it's completely useless. It doesn't do what it was supposed to do any longer. And God looks at Jeremiah and says, now, this belt is my people. Because of their sin and their wickedness and their evil ways, they don't serve the purpose they were intended to serve. So without me, Jeremiah, you need to let them know that they are a useless people. Because remember, back in Genesis and Exodus and early on, we are told that the Israelites were not chosen as God's people because they were great and mighty, right? They were one of the smallest clans, smallest people groups living at the time. They became special because God chose them. And now God is saying, so without me, they're nothing. Just like this linen belt that now is useless and worthless. Such was the life of Jeremiah and his prophecies. Now, the second prophet that was speaking at the same time, or about the same time, was Ezekiel. Now flip ahead to Ezekiel. It's after Jeremiah, which is after Lamentations, which is after Jeremiah. Ezekiel chapter 2. Verses 1 through 10. Ezekiel speaking, and he said to me, son of man, stand up on your feet and I will speak to you. And as he spoke, the Spirit came into me and raised me to my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He, God, said, son of man, I'm sending you to the Israelites, to a rebellious nation that's rebelled against me. They and their fathers have been in revolt against me to this very day. The people to whom I'm sending you are obstinate and stubborn. Say to them, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. And whether they listen or fall or fail to listen, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. And you, son of man, do not be afraid of them or their words. words, do not be afraid, though briars and thorns are all around you, and you live among scorpions. Do not be afraid of what they say or terrified by them, though they are a rebellious house. You must speak my words to them, whether they listen or fail to listen, for they are rebellious. But you, son of man, listen to what I say to you. Do not rebel like that rebellious house. Open your mouth and eat what I give you. Then I looked, and I saw a hand stretched out to me, and it was a scroll which he had rolled before me. And on both sides of it were written words of lament and mourning and woe. Ezekiel, a lot of his prophecy takes place while the people are in Babylon under the reign of King Jehoiakim. The length of his ministry was about 23 years, and God calls him to go and speak to the rebellious Israelites. Notice how many times God called them rebellious in those 10 verses. And he tells him that what the Lord, or he is to tell them what the Lord says, so that the people will know that a prophet of God is among them. Alright? So that the people will know that God is still there, and that God is speaking to them, and that God still loves them and wants them. And then he says, Ezekiel, do not be afraid. He says, no matter what you say, no harm will come to you. That I, God, will be there to deliver you through this. And there are two episodes for us to look at in Ezekiel. Ezekiel 37, one that is probably familiar to us. One may not be as familiar. Ezekiel 37, 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. And he asked me, Son of man, can these bones live? I said, O sovereign Lord, you alone know. And then he said to me, prophesy to these bones and say to them, dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the sovereign Lord says to these bones. I'll make breath and enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I was commanded, and as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them. But there was no breath in them. And then he said to me, prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, this is what the sovereign Lord says. Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe into these slain, that they may live. So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. And then he said to me, son of man, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, but our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, this is what the sovereign Lord says. O my people, I'm going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I'll bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I'll put my spirit in you, and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord. Ezekiel's prophecies had been about the fall of Jerusalem, that if the people did not repent, the people of Judah would fall just like the city was going to fall. And in 586 BC, Jerusalem did fall. And from that point on, then, Ezekiel's prophecies began to speak to the new life of God's people, to them being restored to their future, and to these two nations being united. And these dry bones, then, are an example of that. The dry bones speak to the revival of Israel as God's people. And so Ezekiel has this vision where he's in this valley and all around him are these bones. He refers to them as dry bones, right? Old, bitter bones that have been there a long time. And God speaks to Ezekiel. He says, Ezekiel, prophesy, speak to the bones. And Ezekiel does, and he hears this rattling, and hears this noise, and he looks around, and these bones are beginning to move, and they're beginning to come back together, and muscle and tendons are being coming back on the bones, and skin covers that. And there's these kings now in front of him, but they are not alive. They're not moving until God says, okay, now, Ezekiel, speak to them again. And when you speak to them again, breath will come into them. And so he prophesies again, and breath comes into these bodies, and they become alive. And God said to Ezekiel, tell the people, this is what you've seen, because this is what it means. They're still my people. And a day is coming, Ezekiel, when they will be revived as my nation, when they'll be revived as my people, where they will come to be a holy people once again. This chapter goes on, and we won't read this, but God then shows Ezekiel another example. And he says, Ezekiel, there's two sticks here. One has the name of Judah, referring to the southern kingdom. One has the name of Joseph, referring to the northern kingdom. He says, you can see this stick, it's broken, Ezekiel. He said, I want you to hold them in one hand. And when he held them in one hand, it looked as if it was one continuous stick. And God said, Ezekiel, tell the people, a day is coming when there will not be Israel in the north and Judah in the south, but there will just be one people, my people. A time is coming, God told Ezekiel, when the nation of God will be united as it was intended to be. And so all of this is going on, and there's a lot in there to take in. And so what can we take away? Well, the first is that we are like Judah. How many of us see ourselves in the way Judah lived and behaved and were obedient or not to God? I'm the only one? Okay. How many of us continue in our cycles of sin? How many of us